Live from ABC 7, this is Eyewitness News at 7 p.m. on LA 56.
Three people are found dead inside a burned tire shop. Now police are trying to figure out if the shop was firebombed.
Rescuers are digging through the rubble after a huge earthquake struck Nepal. We'll have the latest, plus hear from local Nepalese who have family in the earthquake zone.
Plus, rain falls around Southern California, and tonight the wind kicks up. Danny is tracking it all with the live Mega Doppler 7000 HD. Good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm Jory Rand.
I'm Giovanna Lotta. Welcome to Eyewitness News on LA 56, LA's only live local newscast at 7 p.m. We begin in South El Monte, where a fire killed three people at a tire shop. Both arson and homicide detectives are on the scene. Eyewitness News reporter Melissa McBride has the latest on this developing story.
Explosions, flames, and smoke. ABC 7 eyewitness Isaac Lopez captured this video moments after a fire started at Check Tires. He called 911 to report the fire and that it was intentionally set at around 5:30 this morning.
As I was getting off the freeway, I saw three guys throwing Molotov cocktails onto this business. Got nothing else to do but cause havoc.
When firefighters arrived on scene, they tried to rescue a man who was on fire. He could not escape the property, and it was difficult for firefighters to get to him.
You had the chain link gate in the front, and then there was also a cement block wall to the, I guess, south, but that also had razor wire on the top.
The firefighter who cut through the fence in hopes of saving the man says he was just doing his job. The victim's relatives came to the scene overcome by grief.
They're grieving. They have a tremendous loss.
Hours after the flames were out, arson investigators from the Sheriff's Department and firefighters began looking for the exact cause of the fire. That's when they discovered two more bodies.
They wanted to slowly and methodically remove pieces of debris from where the existing building was and put it aside so they could come in with their investigators and find out what actually happened here in this fire. While we were removing that debris, we did come across two more bodies inside for a total of three.
Detectives will be looking at surveillance video from local businesses in the area. They believe the suspect fled in a white Chevy Silverado pickup. In South El Monte, I'm Melissa McBride, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
Also developing tonight, homicide detectives are on the scene of a sad discovery in the Westmont area. Deputies find what they say appear to be the remains of an infant in the backyard of a home. The LA County Sheriff's Department is investigating the case. This discovery was made this morning along the 1500 block of West 104th Street. No further details have been released at this time. Anyone with information is urged to call Crime Stoppers at 800-222-TIPS.
Now to the latest on that massive earthquake in Nepal. It struck this morning about 50 miles northwest of the capital of Kathmandu. The U.S. Geological Survey put the magnitude of the quake at 7.8. More than two dozen aftershocks jolted the area after the first earthquake. More than 1,800 people have been killed, but officials warned the death toll would rise. Hundreds more were injured as the earthquake collapsed homes and temples and triggered a landslide on Mount Everest. It is the worst quake to hit the poor South Asian nation in more than eight decades. Eyewitness News reporter Leanne Suter talked with local residents who have loved ones in Nepal.
Namaste Indian Kitchen in Riverside has become a gathering place for Nepalese living in the Inland Empire as they anxiously watch the rescue efforts back in their homeland. Like so many others, owner Devi Charan Gamare finally reached his family after hours of trying to get through.
They have shaved, but some of our houses have been cracked, but I pray for the Nepalese people who have been on this devastation.
He says the images of the damage are gut-wrenching. So many lives lost, so much history destroyed. Those in Nepal say the shaking seemed to last forever.
It went for 3 minutes long, so it was really devastating. And the epicenter was in Kathmandu. That's where my family lives, so that was a really devastating situation to hear.
Most have been able to reach their loved ones by phone or social media, some, though, getting heartbreaking news.
My immediate family is okay. They've gathered at our house. They're staying outside, some in the car, some in the lawn. But I just heard my second cousin got hit with a piece of brick on the head, and she did die instantly.
Watching the images from thousands of miles away, many local Nepalese are praying more will be done to help those still trapped in the rubble.
The main objective is to pull out the most people that we can so that, you know, we can save more lives. I think saving life every minute is a big concern.
Kamire says more than 200 Nepalese families live in the Riverside area. He says in the next day or two, they'll be meeting to talk about what they can do to help their homeland recover from this deadly tragedy. In Riverside, Leanne Suter, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
A team of local firefighters could be on their way to Nepal soon. The California Task Force 2 team is preparing for possible deployment at the LA County Fire's Urban Search and Rescue Headquarters in the San Fernando Valley. The team consists of about 65 people, mostly from LA County, with at least one rescue dog handler from Santa Barbara County. They would be used to dig out trapped survivors. And we will continue to follow developments in Nepal and bring you updates throughout this newscast and on Facebook, Twitter, and ABC7.com.
Now to our weather. We are tracking rain across Southern California right now. Check out this video out of Glendale. You can see the rain coming down pretty hard earlier today. Unfortunately, it is not expected to stick around for long. Let's get right over to Danny Romero and the live Mega Doppler 7000 HD.
All right, thanks very much, Jory and Giovanna. Yeah, not much rain left over Southern California right now. We can see pretty clearly on the live Mega Doppler 7000 HD, many areas are staying fairly dry. Up around Fraser Park, a little isolated, a little shower happening there. But we can see that some spots that have a little difference in the color. The white indicating some snow, a mixture of snow and ice up around Big Bear. Otherwise, in the lower elevations, light rain, all from Running Springs down to Redlands, down to Yucaipa. We're seeing some light rain in the green there on the live Mega Doppler 7000 HD. One other spot to watch, also again, a lot of dry air between that and this here around Wildomar, Lake Elsinore, down around San Clemente to the south. We're showing some of that rain continuing down off the coastal spots just there at the end of Orange County. Now, we do have another part of the weather picture we want to talk about, which is the winds. And the winds are pretty strong, enough to get a high wind warning right now in effect for the Antelope Valley going on until 10 p.m. tonight. Also, Ventura County mountain areas until 10 a.m. tomorrow. These winds here, the darker areas, up to 65, 70 mile per hour gusts. So the winds are pretty strong. But then everything changes in a couple of days. I'll tell you about that with a 7-day when I come back in just a bit. Right now, Giovanna and Jory, it's all yours.
Danny, thank you. In Long Beach, police say a deadly shooting overnight may be gang-related. Officers first responded to a call of shots fired just before midnight on Platt Street. The victim, identified as 34-year-old Donald Parks, was pronounced dead at the scene. Investigators say he was with some people outside a home when the suspect walked up and fired at the group. No one else was hit, and that gunman is still on the loose.
Happening now, protests in Baltimore turned violent tonight. Demonstrators smashed out police car windows and nearby storefronts. This is a live look at the scene tonight. Fans at the nearby Baltimore Orioles-Boston Red Sox game are being asked to stay inside the stadium until that violence dies down. Two people have been injured, and at least a dozen were arrested. Demonstrators are demanding answers about what happened to Freddie Gray, the man who died in police custody. ABC's Gloria Riviera has the latest on a man who may have witnessed it all.
In Baltimore today, the raw anger of a community demanding justice. Marching through the same impoverished neighborhood where 25-year-old Freddie Gray suffered a fatal spinal cord injury while in police custody.
In the middle of this march, you get a sense for a community coming together across racial lines. They're calling for justice for Freddie Gray, an end to police brutality. Freddie Gray's story is one they've heard before. Other victims, similar incidents. Now they're calling for an end to it all.
We fed up. It's been enough.
Okay, y'all dragging.
A community desperate to know what happened when police arrested Gray, then loaded him into a van. Critics say Gray was subjected to a so-called rough ride, where police intentionally start and stop the van. Detectives are now asking for help identifying this man, captured in this surveillance video, across from Gray and the police at the moment of the arrest. Police believe that person may have filmed the encounter. Those officers have been suspended with pay despite calls for their arrest. Local church leaders are also now calling for the police commissioner's resignation.
That's not going to happen.
That was ABC's Gloria Riviera reporting. The University of Maryland has now issued a warning to students due to those protests.
This week marks 100 years since the mass killings of Armenians by the Ottoman Turks. Today, thousands headed to Montebello for the centennial commemoration at the Armenian Genocide Martyrs Monument. They're mourning and remembering the 1.5 million Armenians who were killed in 1915. LA County is home to the largest Armenian population in the U.S., with nearly 200,000 people. people.
This weekend marks the 40th anniversary of the fall of Saigon, which marked the end of the Vietnam War. Tonight, a commemoration ceremony and candlelight vigil is being held at Bolsa Grande High School in Garden Grove. Meantime, a half-size replica of the Vietnam Memorial Wall in Washington went on display today at the USS Midway Aircraft Carrier Museum in San Diego. The wall that heals contains the names of over 58,000 Americans who died in the conflict. A similar memorial called the Moving Wall will be coming to Long Beach in July.
Coming up on Eyewitness News, people put their lives on the line to rescue a woman who fell on the subway track. We'll show you the video.
And a car goes flying through a gas station. How a slushie may have saved the life of that worker inside.
Plus, it's the interview that people cannot stop talking about. We'll have reaction to Bruce Jenner's transgender revelation and some never-before-seen footage. Reaction continues to pour in from around the globe over last night's emotional interview with Bruce Jenner. The ABC News exclusive is still taking social media by storm today, producing more than 1 million tweets. ABC's Chris Connolly has some never-before-seen footage from that interview.
My whole life has prepared me for this moment.
Prepared to disclose a personal truth, kept secret for a lifetime. 39 years of it lived in the public eye. Ever since a victory at the 1976 Summer Olympics.
It's been really tough.
Bruce Jenner telling ABC's Diane Sawyer of life as a transgender person, now transitioning to a woman.
Are you a woman?
Yes, for all intents and purposes, I am a woman. I was not genetically born that way. As of now, have all the male parts and all that kind of stuff, but we still identify as female.
The 65-year-old Jenner, referred to as he during the interview at Jenner's suggestion, disclosing to Sawyer a deep inner torment.
I would say I've always been very confused with my gender identity since I was this big. So here I am stuck, and I hate the word, girl stuck in a guy's body. I hate that terminology.
Why?
I'm me. I'm me. I'm a person. That's, and this is who I am.
Married and divorced three times, most recently to the former Kris Kardashian, matriarch of the Kardashian reality show Empire. Jenner spoke of being sexually attracted only to women.
sexuality is who you are personally attracted to, who you, you know, turns you on, male or female. But gender identity has how to do with who you are as a person and your soul.
Jenner told Sawyer of a plan to drop from view and reemerge later as a transgender woman, now revealing for the first time part of why it took so long.
I couldn't come out earlier and be honest because of my children. I had to get my kids out of the house. I just want to know that my kids are safe and they're secure and they're going to be okay.
And after Friday's interview, support on social media from family members. Kris Jenner tweeting, "My hero." Kim Kardashian, "I love you, Bruce." Hashtag proud daughter. Her sister Chloe, "Bruiser, I'm so proud of you." Their responses matching the support from his mother.
"I was very proud of you when you stood on that podium in Montreal. I never thought I could be more proud of you. But I'm learning I can be."
That was Kris Connolly reporting. ABC's Bruce Jenner interview drew the largest audience for a non-sports show on a Friday night since 2003.
Wow. All right, Danny, talking about the weather, we had some rain today, much needed, but not a lot of it.
Right, not a whole bunch of it, and it's about done. About squeezed out of this sponge all we could and this little system moving through the area. And now get ready for a real turnaround here, a real 180. I'll show you in a second how things are looking. Right now, let's go outside and check out the live Mega Doppler 7000 HD. There are still a couple of spots where a little rainage is coming down, and again, most areas you can see indicating no rain at all. The light green indicating light rain right now, so we can see some of those spots. To zoom in there with the live Mega Doppler 7000 HD. We're showing you one area here around Big Bear, a mixture of snow and ice in the upper elevation. We're thinking like 6,000, 7,000, 8,000 feet and above is where you're going to see any kind of snow or ice from this system. Otherwise, you're seeing all the light green indicating the light rain down to Yucaipa and Running Springs. Also, some light rain showing up after a big dry spot there, down around Wildomar, Murrieta, Temecula, down towards San Clemente. You see this area in the light green indicating some light rain right now. The winds are certainly a part of our weather picture right now. The stronger winds in these areas here in the darker color around Antelope Valley, a high wind warning in effect for another few hours till 10 p.m. tonight. These are 65, 70 mile per hour winds through Antelope Valley, through Ventura County Mountains as well, till tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. And the lighter areas here are wind advisories. These winds not quite as strong. We're still talking, though, 35 mile per hour sustained, occasional gusts 45, 50 miles per hour in these light areas here up around Big Bear as well. Those advisories are in effect until midnight tonight. Outside we go. Ooh, just a stupendous shot. Jay, thank you for this camera look on Irvine Spectrum Camera, HD, Orange County. Looking quite ominous, the clouds are in the distance there. Downtown, a little bit of a break, a little blue skies, a little hint of what's to come. Right now, 62 degrees downtown, 67% relative humidity. And today, our temp below the 74 average, only got to 66 and didn't add any rainfall at all downtown, showing zeros there. Sunset happening in a few minutes officially at 7:32. And today, as far as the rain totals, again, as Giovanna mentioned, not a big rainmaker. 0.14 for Beaumont and Pomona, 0.15 for Lake Forest and Burbank, Ontario. A little bit more there, a little over a third of an inch at 0.37 for rain totals in the last 24 hours. Now, watch. Here's the energy moving through the area. That's that low tracking towards the east and away from Southern California. What we're getting next, the next weather maker will be this ridge of high pressure that locks in. Right about Monday and Tuesday, everything you see now going offshore, and that's going to warm things up quite a bit. We'll see some winds kick up as well, but those temperatures are going to change drastically. I'll show you that momentarily. Right now, I'll show you the numbers tonight. 50s and 40s about everywhere you go. We're showing 69 for a high tomorrow in Thousand Oaks. Enough sunshine, though, to get the 77s for Northridge, Ontario, and Riverside. We look ahead now, 7 day powered by AccuWeather. Mostly sunny skies tomorrow. Look at these temperatures jump to the 80s on Monday, Tuesday. Hold that to midweek. A little less heat, but still upper 70s on Thursday. And by Friday and Saturday, marine layer comes back. Temps getting back down to near normal mid-70s. Valley's Inland Empire on the breezy to windy side. Look at the numbers change, though. 79 to 89 to 91 by Tuesday, and still warm in 80s, taking it to the weekend, 79 for Saturday. For the beaches, we're going to see a great beach couple of days, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, 77. Then the marine layer comes back, cools things down to 70 and 69 by next Friday and Saturday. Mountain spots, still some showers left there during the morning hours tomorrow, and then the sun moves in, the winds kick up, and temperatures jump up to the 70s by Wednesday and Thursday. And the high desert also windy there. Those gusts still strong tomorrow and for a couple of days. And then look at these numbers change, from 72 to as high as 88 by Tuesday and Wednesday, and still Low 80s, upper 70s by next weekend. So lots of sunshine is the next thing on the way.
Okay, Danny.
Sounds good.
Thank you. Yep. A woman barely missed being hit by a speeding train after falling on the tracks. Take a look. The woman was waiting for an Orange Line train in Boston when she slipped and fell. It was all caught on video. Several people were waiting for trains and immediately jumped down from the platform and onto the tracks. They lifted her to safety. About a minute or two later, the train came into the station. The woman was taken to the hospital as a precaution. There were no delays in service.
Wow, that was close. A gas station worker in New York is thanking the slushy machine for possibly saving his life. Derek St. Arnaud was working at a gas station in Perrenton when a car came crashing through the building. It was all caught on surveillance video. Seconds before the crash, he had just walked over to finish preparing those slushy machines. In the end, he only suffered a minor scratch.
I poured the base mix into the container to add the water, and he came in to buy the paper, so I just sat the mix down. I never finished making it, and I rang him up. I was like, oh, slushy mix. Explosion.
Just like that. The driver of the car will be okay. Arnaud says he may not be walking today if he hadn't gone over to that slushy machine at that precise moment.
Wow. Ahead on Eyewitness News, we'll have another look at the wet and windy forecast.
Let's take a live look outside at Long Beach this afternoon. Danny Romero is standing by with the Mega Doppler 7000 HD forecast. Plus this.
This weekend, Angelenos have the chance to view the world's biggest artist colony. We'll take you there after the break.
It was a big day for members of the Pasadena Model Railroad Club in Alhambra. They held an open house at their elaborate train yard today. It's more than 1,700 feet long and takes more than 25 of the 40 members to operate and coordinate 10 trains all running at the same time. The members own their own trains, locomotives, and bring them to the highly detailed landscape. This is the club's 75th anniversary.
Downtown's art scene is big, but you may not know how big. Just east of us is the Brewery Arts Complex, home to the world's biggest artist colony. And this weekend, they're opening their doors to the public. Eyewitness News reporter Adrian Alpert takes a look at the Brewery Art Walk.
Bruce Gray has been creating his sculpture here for 24 years. Teal Hathaway has a cozy hideaway behind her art studio. Carl Smith is an architect and designer. Christine Shoemaker is a painter and performance artist. They are among the 500 artists living and working here in the brewery, a complex spanning 16 acres west of the Golden State Freeway. Starting in 1897, it operated as a brewery for 82 years before becoming an arts complex. Now, after three decades, they claim it's the world's largest artist colony, more artists than anywhere else living and working in one place.
We love having that title, you know, because it inspires other people around the world to create communities just like ours.
Twice a year, the artists open their studios to the public, and this weekend is the Spring Brewery Art Walk.
I get quite a bit of satisfaction just from the feedback. You never get to see more of an artist's work than when you go into their studio.
It's a chance to ask an artist about how the city's old architectural details inspire her work.
I'm a fifth-generation Angeleno, and growing up here, you hear about how there's no history in Los Angeles, and growing up here, I say, yes, there is. This particular piece is my version of the State Theater, which is down on Broadway.
Going to Art Walk is seeing how an architect made a 100-year-old industrial building into a home for his family.
It is like having 1,000 people over for dinner, sort of, yeah. They come right into your space, and so that's part of what makes the Art Walk unique. That's what we really love about it. We spend the whole day talking about our work.
The artists would not mind if you bought their work, but the Brewery Art Walk is free. Because this is where the artists live and work, the Brewery Art Walk is as much about the artists as it is about their art. Adrian Alpert, ABC 7 Eyewitness News, near downtown Los Angeles.
If you missed the Brewery Art Walk today, don't worry. It will be open again tomorrow from 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. They live there.
11 a.m.
to... That's great. That's so interesting.
Yeah, seems really cool. We are updating our top stories at 7:30, including the latest on a fatal fire at a local tire shop.
And the death toll rises above 1,800 in a massive earthquake in Nepal. It triggered an avalanche on Mount Everest, killing 10 people. Many more are still missing. We'll have the latest.
Las authorities investigating a deadly accident on State Route 90. Now police are looking for suspects they think could have been involved in street racing.
And if you're heading to LAX anytime soon, you might notice an increase in security. We'll tell you why right after the break.
Live from ABC7, this is Eyewitness News at 7:30 p.m. on LA 56.
Our top story at 7:30, a raging fire killed three people at a tire shop in South El Monte. I'm Giovanna Lotta.
I'm Jory Rand. This is Eyewitness News on LA 56, LA's only live local newscast at 7:30 p.m. This video was shot by ABC7 eyewitness Isaac Lopez. He called 911 to report the fire, claiming he saw three men throw Molotov cocktails at the building. First responders arrived around 5:30 and found a man on fire. He later died of his injuries. Hours later, two more bodies were found inside the shop. Detectives say they will be reviewing surveillance video from businesses nearby. They believe the suspects fled in a white Chevy Silverado pickup.
Another big story, the massive earthquake in Nepal. It struck this morning about 50 miles northwest of the capital of Kathmandu. The U.S. Geological Survey put the magnitude of the quake at 7.8. More than two dozen aftershocks jolted the area after the first quake. More than 1,800 people have been killed, but officials warn the death toll will rise. Hundreds more were injured. The earthquake collapsed homes and temples and triggered a landslide on Mount Everest. It is the worst quake to hit the poor South Asian nation in more than eight decades. ABC's Hamish McDonald has more.
Tonight, the frantic search for survivors amidst the rubble. The capital of Nepal utterly ravaged by a massive earthquake striking at the height of the day. More than 1,000 confirmed dead, that number expected to rise, and many are buried alive. Witnesses say the ground shook for nearly a minute. Cameras as far away as India catching the tremors. When it was finally over, towns and ancient cities destroyed. Temples prayed to for centuries crumbled in an instant. The sister of an ABC News producer is on the ground in Kathmandu.
I was in a clothing shop that is now covered by rubble, ran out into the street and you could hear screams.
The powerful magnitude 7.8 earthquake unleashing massive avalanches 100 miles away on Mount Everest and neighboring mountains, killing 10 climbers and guides, including at least one American. Google exec Daniel Fredenberg, Google saying in a statement, "We lost one of our own in this tragedy." This earthquake triggered what's known as an aerosol avalanche, a large cloud of snow moving rapidly through the air, creating wind gusts that blew tents across the mountain.
We had quite a big few big avalanches coming down on those faces.
Tonight, many more feared trapped higher up. Back in the capital, fears of more aftershocks.
Every time that there was a tremor, everyone would say, it's coming again, the panic would rise.
Those fears keeping many people outside, afraid to go home where they're sleeping tonight.
People around the city have resorted to sleeping in open spaces, in green parks.
The U.S. is already mobilizing both aid money and rescue teams to Nepal, but the State Department is still trying to establish exactly how many Americans are there and in need of help. Hamish McDonald, ABC News, London.
And we want to make sure you and your family are prepared for the next major earthquake here in Southern California. Check out our extensive Prepare SoCal resources, always available at our website. Remember, get a kit, make a plan, be informed. Go to abc7.com/prepare-socal.
Now to our weather. A storm that brought us some spring showers today is moving on. Many areas saw some much-needed rain, though. You can see a good downpour in Pasadena this afternoon. Chino also got some wet weather. That weather didn't stick around for long, though, but some strong winds are expected to hit tonight. For more on the storm's path and what we can expect, let's check in with Danny Romero. Hey, Danny.
Thanks very much, Jory and Giovanna. Yeah, a lot of things going on for the weather, keeping us busy. Certainly the rain we've had today, then the winds that are kicking up, and then a real big change in the weather. Right now, let's talk about the precipitation that's in the area. Again, you can see many areas are dry right now, but up around Big Bear, some combination of snow and ice there, along with the light rain on the lower elevations down to Yucaipa and to Redlands. And then we see still some light rain also coming down, again, towards the south, Lake Elsinore, around Wildomar, down towards San Clemente. Again, the light green indicating just some light rain amounts at the moment. Other areas you see are very, very dry, but every area has some winds going on, enough to get high wind warnings in effect up around the Antelope Valley here until 10 p.m. tonight, 65, 70-mile-per-hour gusts in these areas, up around the Ventura County area as well. The mountains there till 10 o'clock, or I should say till 10 a.m. tomorrow morning. Strong winds there as well. Then, besides the wind and the rain, heat is on the way. I'll tell you about that with a 7-day in just a little bit. Giovanna, Jory, go ahead.
Okay, Danny, we'll see you then. Many of you have been sharing your pictures and videos of the rain today on social media using the hashtag ABC7Eyewitness. Here's a look at some of the best we've gotten so far. We want to thank you and keep those shots coming. Your images could be featured on our newscast.
The CHP is investigating a deadly accident on State Route 90 overnight. It happened just before 1 this morning on the eastbound 90 at Centinela. Investigators are looking into the possibility that street racing was involved. One person was ejected from a vehicle when it spun out of control and hit the center divider. Officers are looking for at least one other vehicle that may have been involved. And in Riverside, one person was injured when a woman drove her truck into a store. It happened last night on the 2200 block of Main Street. The victim says he was at the cash register when the clerk pushed him out of the way, possibly saving his life. He was treated at the scene. The female driver was arrested and booked for driving under the influence.
Well, another run-in with the law for the Apple Valley man seen on video being beaten by San Bernardino County Sheriff's deputies after a chase that ended on horseback. Authorities say Francis Pusak was jumping fences into backyards in San Bernardino Wednesday morning. When confronted by an off-duty correctional officer, Pusak reportedly began swearing, and the off-duty officer then called the police. Officers responded and gave Pusak a verbal warning. This incident happened one day after San Bernardino County supervisors approved a $650,000 settlement with Pusak over the beating.
Business at the ports of Long Beach and Los Angeles could once again be disrupted within the next few days due to a long-running labor dispute. Truckers are voting this weekend about whether to stay off the job as soon as Monday. Roughly 16,000 truck drivers work at the ports, but it's not clear how many would be affected. Most are independent contractors who want to become employees of trucking companies. Earlier this year, contract negotiations with dock workers caused major delays with imports and exports.
If you're headed to LAX this weekend, you'll probably notice a stronger police presence there. This is a live look at Los Angeles International Airport, where the visibility of airport police was increased today. Officials say they're taking appropriate steps regarding a generic threat made last night against several airports, including LAX, but that there is no specific threat information against LAX.
In Yemen, dozens of airstrikes have been carried out in a southern port city. The attacks happened as Shiite rebels mobilized in an effort to take control of the city. A coalition of countries led by Saudi Arabia began conducting airstrikes against rebel positions last month. Meantime, fierce gun battles continued in neighborhoods as the rebels try and gain a foothold in those districts. More than 550 have been killed in the past month during the war.
Much more news still to come here on Eyewitness News on LA 56, including a look at how National Crime Victims' Rights Week is being honored here in Southern California.
And Arbor Day celebrations are continuing this weekend across Southern California. We'll show you where volunteers were out planting trees and improving local neighborhoods.
Family members of murder victims gathered in Carson today, marking National Crime Victims' Rights Week. More than 250 pictures of murder victims were on display. The event included breakfast and calls for justice. LaWanda Hawkins' son was murdered in 1995. The crime is still unsolved.
We're here to bring attention to these unsolved homicides. In L.A. County, there's too many unsolved homicides. We need to do something about them. We need to educate people regarding this crime called murder and what we can do as people to prevent this.
Similar events were held this week across the country.
Arbor Day celebrations continued today in Sylmar. Mayor Eric Garcetti and Councilmember Felipe Fuentes thanked volunteers who are planting trees throughout L.A. The goal is to increase local water capture and cool our neighborhoods.
Arbor Day is an amazing day that we've had in America forever, but here we're putting it into action because in a drought, trees can be our allies. Trees can help reduce the temperature, which reduces the need for water. They're very efficient compared to grass in actually keeping water here instead of washing it out to the ocean.
Mayor Garcetti says planting trees will help us get through this drought.
A new world record today in Anaheim, and one that might even make you a little dizzy to watch. The crowd goes wild as 9-year-old Olivia Nguyen breaks the Guinness World Record for most consecutive no-handed cartwheels, or aerials as they're known. She completed a record 42 in a row. Olivia's been training for a year, but tumbling for 6 years. All that work paid off today with family and friends there to support her.
Look,
congratulations to her. I know, right?
Great job. Just looking at that scares me. A paddleboarder encounters an incredible sight in Southern California.
Still to come, we'll show you some amazing video of two endangered gray whales swimming right under his board.
Wow, and Yasiel Puig is out of the lineup tonight against San Diego after tweaking his hamstring. Coming up in sports, we'll give you an update of Game 2 between the Dodgers and Padres.
In southern Chile, officials are keeping an eye on a volcano that could erupt for a third time this week. The Calbuco volcano has already forced evacuations and left several feet of ash in some places. It has also filled a nearby river with ash and volcanic mud, affecting international salmon farms.
A frightening scene in Austin, Texas, where a flash flood swept a herd of cows away. The good news is that all of those animals survived and are in good condition tonight. Those cows were caught by high waters and washed under a bridge after it rained really heavily in over a two-hour span in Lee County yesterday. Again, all those cows are all right, but it's difficult video to watch, even worse when you have audio popped
up. It sure is.
Hear them screaming for help.
Yeah. Finally here at 5, a paddleboard enthusiast in San Diego has some pretty sore arms right now.
Yeah, but he says it was well worth it. Here's why. Darren Case was paddleboarding off the coast of Coronado earlier this week. He discovered two endangered gray whales there. They were a female and her calf. Case paddled alongside for 2 hours. The most amazing part, he says, was when they swam beneath him.
Here's the baby and here's the mama whale, and they're right underneath me on the stand-up paddleboard. Well, it's a little intimidating. The size of the creature is so immense that it could crush you if it wanted to.
Wow. Gray whales migrate each year south to have their calves. Once the babies are born, they head back up north to Alaska.
Or they could just emerge and knock you off the paddleboard.
Yeah. That was in Coronado, you said, right?
Yeah,
yeah.
Coronado.
We're
yeah,
that
yeah,
at the
we
very
sure
time.
Did.
Do you ever you see any whales out there in Coronado hanging out?
No.
No?
I saw some in Torrance.
We need to go to San Diego, yeah. Well, you know, and
it's offshore.
The hotel Dell was booked, so
yeah,
just
Dell was the,
keep
yeah.
on going.
Yeah.
Sit on the sand anyway and enjoy a small beverage. That might be the way to go. I saw 5 whales one day after a few beverages. Here's the story right now for us. Outside we go, and yeah, we've got a little bit of rain still with us, although slowly making its way out of the area. We go to our live Megadopter 7000 HD to show you many areas with no rain at all. We can see a lot of dry here from Santa Barbara down through L.A. to Long Beach, but we do have some spots where there is some light rain, even some snow and ice coming down up around Big Bear, around Yucaipa. We can show you some of the light rain going on. And then, of course, we've got some rain to the south of that. Also, this patch of light rain indicated by the light green from Lake Elsinore down through Wildomar and towards San Clemente. But really, not much rain going on at all. The winds, part of the weather picture, so the high wind warnings keep effect. These are the stronger winds up around the Antelope Valley. This is in effect right now till 10 p.m. tonight. And then around the Ventura County Valley, here we're going to see some high wind warnings in effect here as well. And that until 10 a.m. tomorrow morning. Outside we go. Gorgeous views. Malibu Live HD. Shortly after official sunset, it still looks so nice out there on the coast as skies are starting to clear out. Downtown L.A. looking great, 62 degrees at the moment. And here's what's changing about the weather. Here's the weather maker, the low right here. Now watch as it tracks towards the east and out of our area by tomorrow and then into Monday and Tuesday. The next change comes our way. We now see what's going to really make our weather different by Tuesday into Wednesday. This ridge of high pressure right there building in. Now everything goes offshore. Some winds kick up a bit, but more importantly, the temperatures jump up. 10, 15 degrees in some spots from what it's been the last couple of days. Here's our numbers tonight. Down to 50s and 40s in some spots and down to cooler spots, 36 in Fraser Park, 33 at Wrightwood. And then tomorrow's highs, a little sunshine working later in the day. So we're going to get to 74 in Santa Clarita, 77 in Northridge. Redondo Beach goes to 70. We'll see a 76 in San Bernardino. Now here's a 70. Powered by AccuWeather. Look at the numbers jump up. 74 up to 84 is Monday and Tuesday. Still 80s Wednesday. Then a little less heat and then some marine layer returns Friday, Saturday. Back down near normal temp, 76 and 75. For the valleys and the Inland Empire, we've got some winds kicking in and the temperatures jumping up from 79 to 91 by Tuesday. Still 88 and in the 80s Wednesday and Thursday and Friday. And then a little bit less so, 79 for a high on Saturday. So some real warmth coming our way. Look at the beaches. Great beach days, Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday. 77 for the highs Monday and Tuesday. Then the clouds come back. Marine layer returns. Temps start to drop back down to as low as 69 for the high on Saturday. We look to the mountains. Winds are strong. Still a chance of some showers there early tomorrow morning, but the afternoons start clearing things out. The winds kick up, and then by midweek up to the 70s, and then the cool down back to the 60s by Friday and Saturday. Our high desert areas will be windy with gusts of 50, 60 miles per hour. Still warm and windy on Monday as temperatures jump up from 80 to 88. We're pushing 90 degrees in the desert.
Giovanna mentioned earlier, almost summerish, and then still 80s taking us to Thursday and Friday, 78 for the high on Saturday, so the heat is on the way.
Summerish is kind of good.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. It is.
Much better baseball weather.
It is. Yeah. That's true. Feels
let's,
like it.
Let's talk some baseball. Yasiel Puig is not in the lineup for the Dodgers tonight and won't be for some time. Puig may be headed to the disabled list for the first time in his career after re-injuring his hamstring last night. Even without Puig, runs aplenty tonight as the Dodgers and Padres combined for 9 runs in the first 2 innings. We'll have your highlights on ABC 7 at 11 o'clock. Last night, the Clippers went down 2-1 in their best-of-7 series against the Spurs, and the offense struggled mightily. The Clips shot just 35% from the floor. And to make matters worse, the defense was just as bad. Add it all up, it's a 27-point loss in Game 3. Game 4 is tomorrow afternoon in San Antone, and another loss for the Clippers would put them on the brink of elimination.
Most of the time, when things like that happen, you tend to have that hangover. And then, like you said, it's almost like if you miss a shot, if you think about it too much, it can lead to the next shot, before you know it, it goes to the game. So the next day, you got to get over it. It happens. It really does. Like, the shots I got, I hope I get those same shots tomorrow, honestly. Like, they were good shots. They weren't anything rushed or forced or anything. Shots I make 90% of the time in my mind anyway. So for me, I hope I get those same shots.
You can catch Game 4 between the Clips and Spurs Sunday afternoon at 12:30 over on ABC 7 or on your Watch ABC app. Then afterwards, it's Sports Zone. Rob Fukuzaki will be here in studio alongside Lisa Leslie and Michael Cooper for all your highlights. Kurt Sandoval will be live from San Antonio for your post-game reports. Playoff action from today. Chicago looking for the sweep of Milwaukee, but the Bucks, they're hungry. Get it? Just under a minute to go. Bucks with a 3-point lead. Derrick Rose didn't get it. Finds former Laker Pau Gasol, gets the hoop and the harm, ties it up. At 1.3 seconds left, Bucks with the inbounds. And that's your ball game. Bucks shock the Bulls and survive another day. They win at the buzzer 92-90. To the ice. Stanley Cup playoffs. 3 series could come to an end today. This is a good one between the Caps and Islanders in Game 6. Tied at 1, third period. Scuffles going on all over the place. In front of the bench, another one breaks out when Islanders captain John Tavares is hit by Capitals captain Alex Ovechkin. Everyone just stops playing and watch in front of the net. That's Nikolai Kuhlman all alone. That's your game winner. Islanders at an empty netter win 3-1. They stay alive. Game 7 is Monday night.
Coming up next here on Eyewitness News on LA 56, it's a new movie generating a whole lot of buzz.
We'll take you behind the scenes of the new film Age of Adeline, starring Blake Lively. A judge in New Jersey is hoping to put an end to a feud between two parents by ruling that taking a child to a Pink concert is not evidence of bad parenting. A father accused his ex-wife of abusing her parental discretion by taking their 11-year-old daughter to a Pink concert. The judge says while Pink may have some suggestive moves and lyrics, she's an artist whose works aren't necessarily inappropriate for preteens.
New in theaters this weekend, The Age of Adeline. Blake Lively plays a woman who stops aging for decades. Entertainment guru George Pinocchio has the story.
Adeline Marie Bowman was born on January 1st, 1908.
And until a fateful night in 1935, her life was a normal one. A car accident on a rainy night changed everything.
From that moment, she would never age another day.
While you can't see it on the outside, Adeline becomes a very old woman. 82-year-old Ellen Burstyn plays her daughter.
She's such an amazing actress. That's a challenging dynamic to play. But again, you know, she just like, she comes in and she's so open and youthful in the way that she acts that it just makes it easy for us.
In my life, no more than usual. Happy birthday, Mama. Thank you, darling.
In the film, fearing she'll be discovered for her abnormality, Adeline moves every 10 years, changing identities. She just doesn't expect to fall in love with millionaire Ellis Jones.
It was very easy to imagine that Ellis would fall for a woman that has, first of all, so beautiful, but also has such great depth.
As perfect as the music is painful.
You don't like jazz?
No, I love jazz. This is something else.
Adeline's age isn't the only secret revealed in this movie. There's another twist of fate here, too. Now, to capture this woman's 100 years, Lively had to get inside of her head.
You look at Adeline, who came of age in the 20s, and there's something very formal and very proper about her and very contained and very ladylike. So it was really about trying to capture that woman of the 1920s and then weaving in sort of the different decades that would have influenced her and changed her and brought her up to contemporary times.
George Pinocchio, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
Well, it was a reunion of ridiculousness last night in New York as the Tribeca Film Fest paid tribute to Monty Python and the Holy Grail. All of the surviving members of the British comedy troupe attended the 40th anniversary screening, including John Cleese, Eric Idle, Michael Payne, Terry Jones, and Terry Gilliam. They walked the red carpet before the film, or maybe hopped on one leg as they were missing the other leg and both arms. Just a flesh wound. The cult classic cost just $400,000 to make in 1975, but earned over $5 million at the box office and continues to make money today.
Because it was so funny.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks for joining us for Eyewitness News at 7 here on LA 56. LA 56 Weekend Theater is next.
Eyewitness News continues at 11 p.m. on ABC 7 and anytime on abc7.com. And remember, you can get your news 24 hours a day on our ABC 7 Facebook page, on Twitter, and on Instagram.
See you tomorrow night at 7 right here on LA 56. Have a great night, and we'll see you later on ABC 7 at 11 p.m.